Hello! In this video, you will learn about the Automotive SPICE process called Software Unit Verification. To keep it short and sweet, we will focus on the three most important points of this process. My name is Klaus Hermann, and I'm a principal assessor and trainer for Automotive SPICE. It is my passion to bring hard-to-understand models to life so that people can understand them. Okay, let's get started. First of all, why is this process important? You know, this is the first group of tests in a series of subsequent tests. If you don't do unit verification, there will be two negative consequences. Number one, not all problems are guaranteed to be found later, because the subsequent tests have a different focus, such as integration tests and requirements tests. Number two, however, if you find such a problem at a higher test level, you will have to rerun most of the tests in between. The reason for this is that incorrect behavior at the unit level could mask problems at a higher test level. As you can see, this process helps you find more problems while reducing your effort and costs. Okay, let's take a look at the three most important points of the software unit verification process. Point number one is define a strategy for software unit verification. As you may know from some of our videos, a strategy is an easy to understand instructional description. This is especially important for larger distributed projects, so that all people know how to do it. The main purpose of the strategy is to describe how you intend to demonstrate that the software units comply with the detailed design. Three types of verification are required, and you should explain how they should work. First, static and dynamic analysis, that is, checking the code with analysis tools. Second, code reviews, where coworkers read and review the code provided by a colleague. Thirdly, unit tests, where written specifications of tests are used to demonstrate compliance with the detailed design. In addition, Automotive SPICE requires a regression test strategy. Regression testing simply means that if you change something in a unit, you make sure that everything that hasn't changed still works well. A practical example: if you use continuous integration, you typically run all unit tests again during your nightly tests. So, the strategy would be simply the sentence I just said. Point number two is providing bidirectional traceability and consistency to the detailed design. As you may remember, software detailed design is a process on the left-hand side of the V model, and it has a counterpart on the right, which is software unit verification. Three types of traceability are required here. First, for each unit in a detailed design, you know which is the corresponding test spec. Bidirectional traceability means that this works in both directions. Second, for each unit, you know what were the results of code reviews and static analysis. Thirdly, for each unit test spec, you know what were the unit test results. Now, what does consistency mean? For example, for the relationship between a unit in a detailed design and the corresponding test spec, consistency would require that the unit is linked to the correct test and not to the test of another unit. This test is suitable to test the unit completely. If this is not the case, additional tests must be linked. Consistency also requires that the tests actually test the unit correctly. In other words, no faulty tests. Now coming to point number 3. Summarize and communicate the test results. This is usually referred to as a test summary report. And this summary report should be sent to the people who need this information, such as the development team, project manager, quality engineers, and so on. Let's take a closer look at how this report should look. As the name suggests, it should summarize the results and hide unnecessary details. What is the main message that the summary report should convey? Any ideas? Well, it should, of course, show compliance with the detailed design. I'll give you a counterexample that I often see in my assessments. The report contains pie charts showing the 1,520 tests that should have been performed, but of which 112 could not be performed and 89 tests failed. That's it. There's no information as to why the 112 tests could not be carried out and what the risks are. There's also no information about how big the problem is with the 89 failed tests. Nor does the report show compliance with the detailed design. In fact, the detailed design is not mentioned at all. Now, what they should have done is relate the pie chart to the 956 software units, not just to the 1,520 tests. I think you understood the point. This, of course, leads to weaknesses in the assessment. And that's it. I hope this gave you new insights. If you need more information about this process, you can download a software unit verification white paper from our website. It's free. You can find the link in the description below. And don't forget to share this video with your colleagues. Finally, leave a thumbs up if you like the video, subscribe if you want to see more about SPICE, and check out more of our SPICE videos. See you!